Be thankful. Amen. Receive the word with gladness today. Mama is able to save all souls. Amen. Pastor Hill, God bless you. He's over there in the spirit.
All right, praise it. What we going to do? After yesterday, the Lord spoke to me, and before our prayer, the Lord said to me that this is something that we can do on Sunday as well, periodically. You know, just let Sister Davis was flowing in the Holy Ghost. God can flow in a whole lot of different ways, in music, and word, and confessions, and prayer, and intercessions, and special anointings and words. The gifts of the Spirit, God can flow that way, even in a normal service. I don't think that we always have to put time frames on what God needs to do. I believe that we can be open. If God said, I want you to do a full hour on Sunday morning sometime, how many would be open for that? I'm saying, well, it would be as good as it was yesterday. Amen. But just like Sister Davis obeyed the Holy Spirit, you know, God can give us that type of flow. Amen. What we're going to do, we appreciate so much the prayer yesterday. And those that weren't here, you really missed a blessing. And I was just so charged with the anointing. And if I would preach this morning, boy, I tell you, the anointing was all over me this morning. Oh, it was rich. And so I want you to make a special effort next month to set aside time to get in on these prayer meetings. Next month we might have a 4-hour Sunday morning. I mean, we need all we can get and get all we can. How many can say amen? So I want us to never just have a word or two about yesterday's. I think that we ought to support. You know, this is the type of prayer that ministries need to be based on in order to experience the growth, in order for God to do what He really wants to do. It's going to take a lot of prayer. It's going to take prayer. And God has also assured me that this prayer that we'll begin in once per month is going to be followed by, you know, Sunday mornings, we're going to have special service. You know, next one, I just feel maybe the authority of the believer, our rights and privileges in Christ, our confessing the word. Yeah. I mean, just have an explosion. Yeah. I do that on Sunday morning. I won't be sharing my mindset. I get 5 or 6 people get up here and talk faith. I mean, every confession you can find about who you are in Christ. Yeah. And whoever want to talk about who we are in Christ, our righteousness. Amen. I think that new creation realities is something that will really blend well with what Sister Devin is doing. Yeah. I'm in favor once per month. Yeah. Amen. Going all out. Yeah. Amen. Establishing us in who we are in Christ. I just really believe that that's the thing that God wants us to. Sister Devin is going to come now. I want to ask the Woodbearers to come and to share. They've been coming faithfully the last few Sundays, and many of you don't know who they are, what their ministries are, what gifts and what anointings they have. And we just want them to have words, and they're going to be a part of this movement. I just believe they're going to be a part of this movement. They have special anointings, special gifts. And y'all need to know who they are, the Woodbearers. Anybody know the Woodbearers?
Yes.
All right, so the Denise, of course. Powerful thing, but I hear right now singing. I don't know what's that all about, but I'm going to find out. They're going to come shortly. Sister Deborah's going to come first, and the Woodbearers. And I want Brother Billy to help me today to talk. He's probably one of the podcast more faith in the area of finances and just giving and tithing than anybody in here. And I want him to have words because I want several of you to talk on my behalf today. And this is the one that I'm choosing. This is my friend. But he's going to talk, and he's going to help y'all that not quite there yet. And I want to anoint a woman. I don't know who that's going to be. So say, yes, that's the Deborah little baby. And the Lord will deal with that woman. All right. All right, come on, Sister Deborah. And whoever want to talk today, the Lord just said, I was really burning. I have a message just so strong. But the Lord just said, hold on, just see what happens. And you started it. I'm so glad you did that. Hallelujah. Okay, Sister Deborah, that's where we are.
Walk out. You know, the Lord put something strong in your heart, and it's a blessing. Amen. When you can see that being fulfilled. I just want to thank God for our pastors. Even on last night and this morning, I was saying how Pastor and Sister Hill really implanted that desire for prayer. You know, he pushed that for years of praying and reading God's word and reading good books. And all of that has been a part of my life since I've been at Northside. I came here when I was 18, almost 18. And so that never left me. Amen. And so we're so thankful for what the Spirit of the Lord is doing. How many know every round goes higher and higher? Amen. Hallelujah. So just, I don't want to speak long, but just so thankful for the opportunity. Amen. To walk out that prayer vigil. And again, next month we will go forth, amen, for 4 hours. And I'm like, Pastor, let's be open to whatever the Lord wants to say. Amen. I would like to sing, let the church say amen, but I'm not going to do that. So. But God bless you.
All right. So I hope the Holy Ghost is talking to somebody else, because the financial aspect of the ministry is very, very important. I don't think that we are about much if we don't have a healthy attitude toward giving. Anybody hear me?
Amen.
I forgot to come back. I should have came back to Brother Wayne. He always has something good. If you got something good, Brother Wayne, today, never know what happened. When you get something, girl, I think something special about happening. All right, but somebody, amen, got to hear from God, and I'm just going to leave it open just to see what God wants to do, because I don't feel like that we ought to be going through all of these motions and act like we are so spiritual and deep. And don't support what God is doing. And y'all see that this is the thing that we've been praying for years, that God will establish us in righteousness. And we, God has sent good help. You know these brothers here?
Amen.
Good help.
Amen.
And if we're not able to pay them for playing for the children, how much salvation we get? How much Holy Ghost we get? But some of y'all, anybody, need to start tithing. All right, let me know what I'm supposed to do. Okay, maybe brother, you might need to talk about this. Come on. Huh. Oh yeah, I'm sorry, but we really need to come first, because when the money start talking about the money, things kind of change direction. Come on. This is a beautiful couple. Beautiful couple. And God has a whole lot in them. Boy. We haven't been pressuring them, but I sure been praying.
All the best in me, and everyone else around me could only see the worst in me. Can I get just 4 minutes? He's all the best in me.
Yeah.
when the world stands up around you, you can't see anything other than the blessings of the Lord around it, but it can't exceed it. It can't expound upon it because it doesn't see the reflection of what God sees. When you see in the mirror every morning this wonderful reflection of beauty, intelligence, and value, and you ignore it by walking away because you've seen it every day, God is telling you, I saw the best. I didn't see the worst. I didn't see a mistake. I didn't see an accident. I didn't see an unintentional coincidence. I saw the best. And when my God looks back at me and tells me that I see the best, and I say, no, God, I made a mistake today. I couldn't do it today. I couldn't venture today. I couldn't understand it. God still said, no, son, you're the best. You are designed uniquely to be the one and only you. So I don't care how many times someone has told you you're ugly, you're unintelligent, you're not valuable, you're just like your mama, you're just like your dad, you're just like all of those things in this world. I created you to be the best. And instead of believing 2 + 2 = 5, you guys, accept it on the truth that God made you perfectly, wonderfully designed. And no matter what someone sows into you, if it is not the truth of the Lord that you are awesome, you better say 2 + 2 = 5. So as we stand here, I'm going to paint one more picture for you. Imagine in heaven God sitting at the throne, a table spread as far as you can see. Imagine seeing goldware, the finest china. Not out of crystal balls, but a diamond balls, full of all the wonderful things that the Lord is about to put into himself, because he made you for himself. Now imagine this. As he prepares that table, he sees it. And we are those vegetables, because we've asked him to be the vessels, the instruments. So he looks upon us. He sees the spoon. Maybe that's me. He sees the spoon before. Maybe that's you. Maybe back there, that's the knife. And we're presenting ourselves faultless. But he looks down and he sees a dirty instrument. Our God is not going to use that dirty instrument. He's going to slide to the side. But here's a good message. Jesus will take what's dirty and turn it back in. So rather than that vessel being not used, Jesus will slide it back to him and say, here you go, God. God the Father will pick that up. And then he'll take that nostril, that flavor, that chicken, that mashed potatoes and go, that good and faithful servant, well done. Don't you want the master to talk to you about that and like that? Well, let me hear. He's already doing so. I want you to understand that your mind is the most powerful thing that you have and you'll ever have. Don't see something that God doesn't see just because everyone has told you that's who you are, what you are, and what you can be. Because as the message in the song was, he saw the best. If he saw the best, don't fall for the rest.
Well, hello everyone. I am Michelle. And I am his wife. And we have been married for 8 years now. Is that right? Okay. 8 years. And I'm an educator. I teach special education to kids. I love young people. I love watching them up here. I'm singing a song and everything. And something to kind of piggyback on what he said, you know, I call my kids superstars every day. And I say, you're a superstar. You high five, you're a superstar. And he said, so Mary, why do you call me a superstar? I said, because that's who you are. And they said, but I'm not good at math, I'm not good at reading. I said, I don't care. You're a superstar right now. Why? Because I'm gonna build you up to get you where you need to be. Because you're a superstar. If I keep saying you're a superstar over and over, guess what you're gonna believe? Ah, yes. So guess what? This year has been a very great year education-wise. I told my husband, I said, I believe that kids can do whatever you want them to do if you push them. So I've been pushing the mess out of my kids. My kids love me, but I push hard. But I love them at the same time. And I have had a good, bad problem. Some of my kids have gotten released from special ed, which is rare nowadays, if you don't know. Once they slap that label on you, they keep on you forever. Did y'all know that?
Yes.
Okay. So if you need help with special education, I'm the one for you. Before they slap a label on your kid, please come to me and talk to me. Okay? Because I can normally find out what's the real issue of them help education-wise and help them get past that area. Okay? So don't let them slap a label on them first. But if they do, I can still help. All right?
Hopefully the singing in this was great, but what I've learned over the years is this: have them asking for more, but not begging for this. So praise God. Hopefully it was a blessing. Thank you so much for this time.
All right. Praise the Lord. We didn't know we had all of this on the mission. All right. What's the blessing? That was good. We'll get off. All right, come on, Brother Billy. We don't hardly hear a whole lot, but he needs to speak now. And give us a motivation.
Praise the Lord, saints.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I believe in what the Word says. Okay? And as I grew up as a kid, we were taught the scripture, well, man robbed God. You know, and you see people every day robbing people, robbing stores, giving stores, banks. But when a man robbed God, think about that. You know, and he went, well, how can I rob God? God pray a prayer. But you know, the Bible tells us, in tithes and offerings. You know, years ago when I was a kid, I was saved. You know, in the Holiness Church, where we had church every day of the week, honey. Saved my kids, you know. And we were always in church, you know. If I was mom and dad with church, I was to church. And if I made up too much noise, I got to get in my mouth. You know, that's child abuse today. You know, that's the way it really was back then. And we were taught, you know, always take something to the church. If you have the 2 pennies, you know, and you have offering cards, you take your 2 pennies up there. And that was instilled in me to always give to the church, always. And I've always been a giver. Well, even my wife got saved after I got married before I did, you know, it was a thing that she did. She always continued to pay her tithes. And I always made sure, okay, that you make sure you got to pay your tithes, you know. I was doing everything else. You know, I ran clubs, did all kinds of stuff, but I made sure she had her tithes to get to the territory. I knew through her that we were going to be blessed. Not knowing if I'm thinking, well, normally she's doing this, you know, God's gonna bless her, you know. And it's my wife, so I'm gonna be blessed. You know, this is how the devil tricks us. I'm not telling you, this is true. There's a lot of us out there. Well, I used to be out there, not anymore, but there was a lot of us out there. We thought, well, my wife is going to church, she's doing everything, so okay, I'm good. You know, she's gonna come to me with her prayer. And which she did. I mean, I knew I seen things, I'd go home on the weekend and say, look. Babe, I said, you were praying for me, weren't you? She said, always. You know, I didn't get into a predicament and get out of it without knowing how. But I knew it was through her prayers.
Yes, yeah. Amen.
So eventually, God brought me down to where he could talk to me. You know, he got me down to the level. You know, I used to work for Halliburton Oil Company, you know, oil boom back then with a lot of money. So I couldn't hear God too good because I'm making good money and doing all the things I want to do. So he allowed the enemy to take that job from me. So now I ain't making this money, so I can hear him. He got my attention. But I knew what it was happening. You know, I was growing up in the church. I mean, I grew up knew all about what God was doing for me. So I knew what was happening. So my wife, she was getting, don't worry about it, baby. I said, you're a Christian woman. She gave me a tithe, she gave me a prayer. God's not going to let you suffer. I quote the scripture to her. I grew up in the church. I knew the scripture. You know, I would tell her that she looked at me like, okay. And finally, she got on the bandwagon, you know, okay. So he knows what he's talking about. Now, she had more faith than I am. And so she started believing more, knowing what she was supposed to do. And didn't worry about our situation. So I go maybe a year and a half or so. You know, I'm born to go back to school. I think I was bringing home from my $200 a month on a part-time job, unemployment and stuff. But It was 6 months after I left, I gave my life to Christ and received the Holy Ghost instantly. Because I knew that God had called me to work for Him. So at that moment, as soon as I gave my life to Christ, I instantly received the Holy Ghost. And I thought, well, Lord, I know you got something for me. And He did. And from that day forward, I made a vow that I would always give above what my tithe was. My offering would always be above. I'd always been, the cliche was, when you give into an offering, you give a dollar. And your tithe is $1,000, but you put $1 in offering. I'm thinking, okay, that don't balance out right. Now, your tithe is what you bring back, but your offering is what you receive above. You know, the offering is what you're going to be blessed on. So if you give $1,000 tithe, your offering is at least 100 or more. I mean, that's my favorite. I'm thinking this in my head. So, you know, I've always tried to give above what my offering should be. I thought, no. That is what God's looking at. He's not looking at my tithes, it's His already. That's not mine, that's His. You know? But now my offering is where I'm going to get mine from. You know, His window's going to open up. He's going to pull up, the stuff going to fall. I'm going to walk down the street and bless me. Oh, look, where that stuff from? It's because I gave above. You know, not that I just gave what I had, but He told me to give you 10%. No, bring it back. It's not yours, no. Now, see, if I give you $1, by the way, if I say, every dollar I give you, guys want to give me a dime back. We got a deal then.
That's a deal.
That's what God said. I'm going to give you $1. I just want you to bring it back. So bring it back and enjoy it. We have for you.
Yeah. How do you obey God with that?
Okay.
How's that for
you? My wife and I, you know, I said, we're a team. We've been together 42 years. And the last 30-some years, you know, we've always dealt together. We pray together. We talk to God. And we listen. Most times when God speaks, me, He speaks to her. And you may hear it when God's put forth something like a special project, God gives me a number. And I'll look at her and say, okay, babe. I say, how much is that? She said, well, she said, I'm thinking. That's what God said. Yeah, and that's why we give what we give. We don't sit down and we afford it. When we get that number, God gives us a number, 500,000, 5,000, whatever. Okay, and her number is equal to mine. We have no problem with that. That's God. He gave it to us. Yeah. I come from Clinton, Oklahoma. If I could take something out of Clinton to see where I grew up at, you would say, he didn't come from nothing, did you? There was 13 kids in a four-room house. Yeah, 13 of us. I got 8 sisters and 5 boys. Yeah, and we didn't know we was poor. Because my mother wasn't good, but my daddy used to be a preacher. God took care of us. He fed us good, He kept us, and He taught us love. So when you get yourself to a place where you can hear from God, your giving will open up, and your receiving will be greater than that.
Yes. Amen.
Oh man, that was the message. I don't see no excitement though. That's good. I don't like to preach it because people don't get excited. But that was good. That was a blessing. All right, do we have someone else that would like to come to this? Anybody else? All right, David is going to come. All right. You can come. Brother Sonny, he was a blessing last week. He just told me that he was a blessing. Would you tell him, Brother Sonny? All right. Is it a struggle for you? Is it a joy? All right. So, Brother David is going.
John 8:32. I can give you 31 first. All right. It said, then said Jesus to those Jews believed on him. If ye continue in my word, then ye are my disciples indeed. How many of you all know indeed means you're doing something?
All right, you want the mic or you just going to talk with
me? I And verse 32 says, and ye shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free. There's liberty and freedom. And when I say there's liberty and freedom, we're talking about your pocket too. You know, I found that bondage comes when there's lack. Bondage comes when there's lack. But when there's overflow, there's some freedom there.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. And so I'm reminded of the scriptures that say, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure.
Yeah, yeah.
Pressed down, shaking together, running over.
Yes.
Shall what?
Yeah, yeah.
Men give unto you. Well, that scripture is talking about love. Giving love. And so what I found is tithe and offering is based upon relationship.
Yes, yes, yes.
Because of the relationship you have with your Heavenly Father, there's liberty to give. And so in relationship, you begin to know some things. And so one of the wonderful things that I loved about prayer yesterday is it gave us an opportunity to speak the word and prayer. I think one of the things we talked about in Bible study, we got prayer and we have the word of God. And so prayer is like breathing. And the word of God is like eating. You can be a breather and don't eat, and eventually you're going to die. And then you can be an eater and don't breathe, and you'll suffocate. And so it's the two of them working together. I think Pastor went over a scripture in Bible study the other day over in Proverbs. I think it was Proverbs 16. Let's go over there real quick. Verse 23. It said, the heart of the wise teacheth his what?
Mouth.
Faith come by what?
Hearing.
Hearing by the what?
Word of God.
Word of God. By out of the abundance of the heart, the what?
Mouth.
Mouth speak. And so out of that heart shall flow what? Rivers of new what? Water. The washing of the water of the what? Word. So the heart of the wise teaches his mouth and added learning to his lips. And so when you begin to flow out of the belly, out of the heart flows that river. You begin to speak the word. And some things begin to happen. Faith begins to happen. So we all know it's impossible to please God without what? Faith, right? So we need faith. But faith is the word. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. The word, right? It's the substance of the things that we hope for. The evidence of things we haven't seen is you work in the word. Amen? I believe Christ is the head, right? And we are his what? Body. His instrument, his workmanship, right? And so when I see Sister Deborah, I don't call her head different from her body, right? I don't say that's Sister Deborah's head and then her body is Billy, or her body is a different name, right? So we are his body, his workmanship. So he has to work through what? The body. That's us, right? Well, look at verse 24. It said, pleasant words are as honeycomb. Sweet to the what?
Soul.
And healing of that bones. What I love about that sweet to the soul is in the commandment that he gave us, he said, love God with all your heart. That's the spirit, man. Then the soul. That's your will and emotions. And then he says your mind, your intellect and your imagination. Here, the soul is encompassed of all those things. It's encompassed of your will and emotions and your mind, your intellect and your imagination. So he said, pleasant words, when you begin to speak the word from out of the inside, see, because of relationship with your Heavenly Father. When you begin to speak the word, your soul is shaped by God's intellect. Your soul is shaped by God's imagination. And then it says the second commandment is like unto it, to love your neighbor as yourself. The next scripture say, on these two commandments, you can hang all the law, as spiritual and physical. We learned yesterday that we have two different realms, I believe, Sister Deborah said, the spiritual realm and the physical realm. And so I think we need to know some things in the spirit so that we can see evidence of those things in the natural. See? And then we can operate in what? Overflow. Our glass needs to get filled, but it comes through the word. Praying the word. I believe that one parable said, these things come out through prayer and fasting. Well, what is he talking about? He's talking about doubt and unbelief, your insecurities. And so this financial thing, as it relates to the church, is a symptom of something way deeper. And I think we got to begin to deal with that root. The pastor's doing an excellent job with the redemptive realities, what Christ actually did. Because we're hanging on to something that God is expecting us to release. He said, give. Huh? He said, give, and it shall what? Be what? Given unto you. But the first requirement is the what? Give. See? So continue to give love up to him. Continue to study your word. Continue to stay in your word. Continue to make it first place. And you will watch your finances grow. See? You will watch wisdom grow, knowledge grow, understanding grow. Your spiritual eyes being light. You have spiritual ears to hear. That's where our brother was at. See? He had enough sense to just believe God for a number. Well, what number? See, that just let me know he got spiritual ears to hear. See? So the same five senses you have in the natural realm, you have in what? Spiritual realm. You got to use them. I know we exercise them in the natural, but we got to begin to exercise them in the spirit realm. So when we begin to exercise them in the spirit realm, so things will happen for us naturally. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Yeah, I was going to say something real quick.
Come on down. These are just ordered. I mean, they just ordered their
person. I'm just going to keep it real simple. Last week, I kind of said something about, you know, me coming from nothing. You know, I stopped living with my mother and father, age 10 or 11. And I've been making my own decisions since I was 11 years old, just point blank. You know, I didn't have nobody showing me anything until my grandfather, you know, stepped into my life 7, 8 years later. 5 years later, and I can understand what Brother Williams is talking about. Sometimes you just got to give. You know, me and my wife just give out of pure obedience. You know, whatever. If this is what God say do, just do it. Like I say, I come from nothing. It ain't mine. Just do it, you know. I look at everything I do as a blessing. Everything is bonus to me. So if there's a need, and I've always been an unselfish person. I'm not calling, you know, people who don't tie selfish. I'm just saying, I've never, even when I wasn't saved, I wasn't selfish. I've always, ego, you know, trying to help whoever came my way, you know, because that's just my heart. That's my nature. That's just who I am. And once I find out about saving and giving, I'm sorry, tithing, giving, and all that old stuff, it just increased, intensified. I'm like, wow, that's what God wants to do. I'm already doing that, but I'm not giving to a church or anything. But it's no problem for me to help anybody. I'm always trying to do what I can do to help somebody. And I just encourage everybody, you know, to just continue to give, pay tithes. And just do it out of obedience and don't even worry about the money. Like Brother Sonny said, just pay for it. That's all it is. If you got faith and you know that God, if you know what God is telling you to do, the money, I mean, your needs is going to be met. If you have doubt and you give in without pureness, then the results is what it is. So, I like to say, I just give. To, you know, this is what I'm supposed to do.
All right, I'm going to ask Brother Wayne to pray. Come and pray. This is going to be for every person that really have purpose in your heart that you want to give at least $100. You don't have to do it today, but you can do it by next Sunday. No later than the first Sunday. And I'm going to ask Sister Hill made me to be in competition with me. We're going to do it by the first Sunday. So she's going to be responsible for half of it. But I think the men can outbeat the women. Yeah, this is just for this month. Put it, special project. Women, I'll just let you raise $2,500. I'll raise $2,500. So that's the easiest way. You can call anybody you want to, you can connect with anybody, you can give it all yourself. Keep that temper light. But the Lord is waiting to pray, and all of you that not quite there in your faith, and he's going to help to get you there. So listen to things, God bless you.
Amen. The Lord just brought to my heart what I probably should have shared last week. But Michael took up all the time, so. but this is what, you know, this is what, I'm going to tell you a little story about faith. And when we came down here, you know, we came down here to go to Rhema, and, you know, he left working at General Motors 18 years. I worked at Ford for 15 years, and you know, we couldn't quite understand, you know, why are we coming down here, Ford, you know? And, you know, so my relationship with the Lord is I felt like he jacked me up and my feet were dangling. And he said, I need you to come down here because you just finished, you know, going to Bible study. However, and that was really good. He said, but I've got 10 times more to teach you for you to experience coming down here. And so when we got down here, you know, I kept saying, well, how are we going to afford this, Lord? You know, I didn't have a job. You know, Michael got this little job, and, you know, we both worked for an automotive company. You know, we were paid very well, you know. And I wasn't in the habit of really talking to God about finances because I didn't need to, you know. I mean, we gave our tithes and whatnot, but to actually talk about it and ask him, you know, because there was abundance, there wasn't a need, you know? So part of the things that we had to learn coming down here is to depend on God for each and everything. And so, you know, we're looking for a house, you know, and I'm an accountant by profession. So I'm a numbers person. You know, I had my little spreadsheet out, you know, And then I say, hey, God, how about this? What about this? And he would scratch that, and I'll start all over. This is where we need to be. And so when I found the house that Michael was talking about last week, the night before, I'm sitting there at the, not the night, well, maybe a week before, I'm sitting at the kitchen table, and I'm saying, God, you know, how do we do this, you know? I mean, we can't afford this, and we can't afford that, and, you know, how's this going to work out? So school had started, and so one of my favorite teachers at Rhema was Keith Moore. And so we're in the big auditorium. You know, they had to be probably 1,500 people. And he was walking around, and he got over to me, and he just kind of stood in my vicinity, and he pointed his finger, and he said, don't you ever say what you can't afford. He said, don't put God in the box. He says, your job is not your source.
Amen.
And I'm thinking, did I have microphones in my house bugged? I'm like, I mean, I am just going crazy. I wanted to slide up under that chair like, oh my gosh, you know. I said, somebody is listening to my conversation to God. And Keith Moore spoke through, God spoke through Keith Moore to tell me that don't put God in a box. Your source is God, not your job. So as you said, you know, money is just paper. We have got to get that attitude that when we have a need, God's going to supply it. So we have a need here, God's going to supply it. But we have to step out, and until we step, God's not kicking in. We have to first step out, and then God comes and takes that next leg and moves us forward. So we cannot be afraid that if I give my last, that's it. You know, no, if you give your last, that's the beginning. Amen.
All right, I guess you got the word today. All right, come on. Y'all get ready. Now, we're going to bring Sister Deborah a $20 offering. If you were there yesterday, and it was on my heart that everybody that attended that session should at least done $25. It was in my heart. And so we want you all, everybody that could just be a blessing to her, and we want to do more than all of those people that were there yesterday. Amen. So, because this is helping to establish this ministry, the prayer, and that's where it starts. So we want y'all to get ready, bring the Lord an offering on the pledge money. You can determine whether you want to do it today, next Sunday, or the first Sunday. My sister Hill will be in charge of the women, and I'm going to be in charge. My brother Muted, I put it in charge. But I'll let you know. All right, Brother Wayne, you're going to pray that God really will begin to move on their hearts and open doors, and their faith will come to a point where they won't be too stressed to believe God for what that's all about.
Same one will see deliverance. But a lot of time we don't want to continue to press on. We want to, you know, whatever we're believing for, we want something to happen so immediately. But in most cases, it's not. Before you experience things that you want God to bless you and come through for you, most times it's going to get darker as you get close to what you believe in God for. I mean, even our own personal life, I can say that we can, maybe my wife, we can just say, well, maybe not guilty even the things we experience on our job, the different changes. But it's who we see. I mean, who do you see the supplies on your need? I mean, what is your focus is on? Is it God? What he said in his word about supply your need? He has supplied all of our needs according to his riches in glory to Christ. Every single time. We was in a meeting, I think this week, no, it was last week, and I had asked one of the plant managers, because it was kind of, you know, puzzling me during this time before our company is going through a merger. And I asked him, why are we hired? I mean, when you hear all the other oil company people just laying off thousands and thousands, and I couldn't understand why this particular facility was hired. And it just kind of seemed strange. And they gave me a reason because we lost so many people last year due to what the layoff or whatever, some of them just went into retirement. We need to replace those. And you would think that, and he asked me, well, would you hire now? I said, no, I wouldn't hire now. Left up to me. See, some things it puzzles your mind about the way God works. He don't work like we think he would work. And these people, I don't know if they know that much about God or the different managers or whatever, but it seems like they're doing things differently than what the norm would do. What the most people would think. What they're doing, they're going shopping for quality help in the low time, seem like. But they can hire people at lower wages normally that they wouldn't be able to get. When time to hire one of the other, seemingly with the shortest of machines. And a lot of times in our own lives, we think that when you see all the bad news of what's going on in the company, the economy, we want to hold back. We don't want to do this. What we desire, or we want to give is to the kingdom of God, but we don't wait and see what my situation is going to pan out. I'm going to wait and see if things are going to get better. We can't look at things like that. Because he gives his seed to a sower. I don't know about you and why you see, how you see God's word and who you are, what we've been confessing, that you are a sower. He gave a seed to a sower. Hallelujah. And he would multiply, that is the word, he said, multiply the seed that is sown. He didn't just leave you at the doorstep and say, I just want you to give and sow. But as a result of you obeying his word and doing what his word said, not watching the clouds of what's going on in the atmosphere and what's going on in the economy, but God's economy has not changed. What he has promised and what he has spoken, he can fulfill it. I can't wait to see what's going to happen and say, well, we better hold up and wait and come up in May whether or not they're going to put a padlock on this place. Hallelujah. But no, I've made up my mind. We are made up my mind. We're going to keep on giving. But God is our source. Hallelujah. Glory to God. It all depends on who you put your trust in, who you put your confidence in. In your bank account or God's bank account. I'm going to put my bank account on here. Because he is able to do exceedingly abundant of all I think of as according to the power that works within us. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We have his promise to stand on. and watch him perform in the midst of us. And I just, you know, was going to share this, and we'll go into our prayer, because I met my wife, she don't mind me sharing, we're coming up 35 years of marriage, coming in a couple more weeks. Hallelujah. And I just watched her, this little cottage, I shouldn't say little cottage, this cottage she had bought back in, I believe, July. I believe it was July, right? Was it July?
September.
Wow. July, man. But the thing of it is, she told me she just made her last payment, I believe, this month. She did. I've been having my ass for almost 2 years, and I still ain't paid off yet. And that thing ain't cheap. I'm just keeping it serious. She believed God, and she aggressively.
Praise God.
Amen. Give all the time.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. But we can, if you want to take, you know, the back seat of this thing and say, I'm just going to be reserved, I'm just going to wait and see how this thing unfold. Or you can be one of those that I'm going to kill. Lord, I'm going to bless you. Because you got to understand, also giving of money and tithes and offerings are part of worship. It's one thing talking about who your God is, but then there'll come a time when it's time for you to prove who your God is. And let him prove to you, the Bible says, prove me. But I will not open the windows of heaven and pour out you a blessing that you won't have room enough to receive it. These are things we constantly even tell, we need to confess, but you said you were going to do.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Glory to God. Well, who report are you going to believe?
Hallelujah.
That you didn't ever giant. Remember we sharing this in one survey about the giants in the land? When they went and spied the land, what did they see? Giants? Some saw one of the things. But I guess my question was when I was sharing this, man, where them giants come from? How did it come about? Somebody had to sow a giant seed. That's the only way they came on the scene. And if you want something big from God, you got to change the size of your seed that you sown. You want a big harvest, you want a big increase, get bigger. I mean, that's his promise. It doesn't matter. Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord. He's more than able to do it. Just trust him and put your confidence. Do not regard to the sign, you know, what's going on in the economy, what's going on. But let your eyes continue to be on focus on what his word and what his promise is. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's just stand. Father, we just thank you. We give you the praise and the glory for your word. We thank you how you watch over your word to form it, Father God. We know, Lord, that you're not like man, Lord God, observing the times, different things going on the earth. But Lord, you are faithful. You're faithful in that as the sun rises from the east and also sets in the west, you continue to show your faithfulness, God, to us. Allow us every morning, Lord, to see a new day, a fresh beginning, a fresh opportunity. Lord, to serve you, to do those things that are pleasing your sight, Lord God. We do thank you, Lord, for every opportunity to give. Lord, let us know that you gave us your very best, your Son, Father, that we might enjoy the pleasure that we do enjoy. But Lord, you have greater things in store for us as a church, as individual families, Lord God. We thank you, Father God, for blessing each and every family individually. Lord, thank you for giving them a heart, Lord, to give. Plus, and also a heart to receive. To receive that what you have for them are the most. For you said you know what we have need of before we even ask. But Lord, we thank you, O God, that you have supplied all of our needs according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Your promise, Lord, are yea and amen, so be it. Hallelujah. According to our faith, let us believe and trust you, Lord. But Lord, some of these things you're going to do through us as an individual and as a church is because of your name's sake. Hallelujah. Glory to God. It's that we rely on what our own personal resources. But it will be a work of God. Hallelujah. In such a way, the Lord, that we take note and say in our own self, this must be God and not a man. Because Lord, you can perform it, God. This work gonna be quick. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, for the harvest of people, Lord God, who come through this ministry, Lord, to be ministered to. We thank you, Lord God, even for the lady that came last week. Hallelujah. What would have happened, Lord God, if that soul came by and our church was closed? Hallelujah. Lord, let us realize, Lord God, this church is not just for us, but for the people of this community to come find rest unto their soul. Hallelujah, to be revived. Hallelujah, to be renewed, to be refreshed. Hallelujah, to be soul, salvation, deliverance in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. And Father, you have forgotten about us personally in our own lives and our own family. How your promises, oh God, hallelujah, should not fall short for what you have spoken over them. The soul salvation of their loved ones. Hallelujah. And those are being saved. And Lord, we thank you, Father God, for everyone that is here, that have given to the Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord God, for showing them, Lord, your salvation, oh God, and your deliverance, Lord, in their own personal life. That they may know, Lord God, that you confirm your word, oh Lord, in the midst of them. That already have been spoken, Father God. It shall come to pass, and they're going to see it with their own eyes, Lord God, the fulfillment of your word that you have spoken to them, into them, Father God, in the name of Jesus. We believe your word, Lord God. We believe your promise, oh God, and provision that you have made unto us. You see, you gave us your very best. Your son, oh God, how be it with him when you freely give us all things to enjoy. For the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father God. We give you the praise. We give you the glory, Father God, for all that you are doing. But truly, you are awesome, God, oh God. You are faithful, oh God, that is promised, oh God. You stand behind your word, oh God. Hallelujah. That what you have spoken, oh God. Heaven and earth may pray, but Lord, not one jot or tittle your word. Hallelujah, shall fail, oh God. We thank you, Lord, that your eyes run to and fro, Lord. To sow yourself strongly on the behalf of those, oh God. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father God. We rejoice in you, oh God. We praise you, Lord. We magnify your name, oh Lord God. For truly you are awesome, oh God, in this place. Thank you, Father God. Hallelujah. You are worthy to be praised. From the rise of the sun, oh God, to the setting out of his name. Your name is to be proclaimed, oh God. Your name shall be lifted up, oh God. We rejoice in you, Lord God, even in this day, even in this hour, Lord. We magnify you, oh God, for what you are doing, Lord. Not only what you do, Lord, but just for who you are. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We thank you, Father God, for your word. Hallelujah. The kingdom of God, hallelujah.
hallelujah, is not meat and drink, but righteousness, joy, hallelujah, in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. Whatsoever you ask of you, O God, you shall give it, Lord. If you're not like man, O God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. For you will give us, O Lord, the desires of even of that which of our heart. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for it is your will. Hallelujah. Glory to God. In the name of Jesus, we give you the praise and we worship you, Lord. Thank you, Father God. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah.
Deborah, what she did yesterday, and it's really proud of that, amen, how well everything was carried out. And even today, all of those that ministered, Sister Davis, Brother Dave, Brother Wayne, Brother Marico, Brother, who else? Brother Beauty. Yes, the couple, yeah, the Whitbearers. Man, alive. Oh, you want to sing a little bit more of that song? What's the name of it? Oh, the words come. That's all I said. All right. What we're doing is that we're going to pay off phase two of this deal here. We had phase one finance, but I think that we're going to be able to pay that off way ahead of too. So by the first Sunday, we'll be able to have phase two pay, and phase one, we might be able to have that half pay. Maybe you got too old, you should have done that. Let's all sing. Praise the Lord. Raise your hand, the blessings of the Lord making me rich. How about y'all say something? Say it again, the blessings of the Lord. And there is no sorrow. In the name of Jesus, we speak to the ministry of spirits. Oh, I'm telling you, it's a faith church. But we all, maybe that's too late. Go out and bring that $25. That's more like it for y'all. May the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us now, this Lord, and forever. Everybody say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. All right.